40 years ago, Howden, Yorkshire, the construction of a mammoth. In a special hangar rises a spider's web of metal, a frame to support gas bags holding 5 million cubic feet of hydrogen, lifting power to link the continents by airship. When completed, R-100 flew many times, once even to Canada and back. Yet this was a ship destined never to enter service. Her girders to be reincarnated as pots and pans. Vision, like vaulting ambition, sometimes leaps too far for the immediate present. But that's the chance men take when they think big. During the last century, our world has advanced at an unprecedented rate. Witness the London skyline. The impressive of yesterday becomes the dwarf of today. A proud palace of bishops is cowed by a prosaic power station. Weaving in and out the all-pervading internal combustion engine. Unseen, electronics, atomic energy, the orbiting satellite. Progress is a hard pacemaker, and today few possess what it takes to go it alone. Today, development is a matter less of individual genius than of people in teams, groups, and organizations. Here is an organization which has marched in step for more than a century. Because it has done so much, it is now, not surprisingly, big. Big and a business, and thereby big business. What does it make then? What kind of service does it give? We say it, but an organization is basically people. So to find out exactly what they do, well, I wonder if they'd let us in on the board meeting. Oh, but it hasn't started yet, anyway. Well, let's first try that other one, way back. Its minutes are to be found in records, along with a million other documents, letters, memos, invoices, blueprints, diagrams, drawings, and photographs. For a company, like a maiden aunt, hoards the lot. And a company swollen into a group, well, it's pooling the hoards of 50 maiden aunts. Minutes for the meeting of December 31st, 1867. Profit and loss account, general statements, funds put aside, assets. What was the 9 and 9 pence for? And those who dictated, wrote and signed in that beautiful copperplate, who were they then? Men in steel and engineering, fathers and sons from Sheffield, rivals from Newcastle, who ultimately became partners because their aims were the same, to become the blacksmiths and the armorers of the nation. The pictures that remain of them are few but impressive, of groups by bridges and other mightier structures, of top hats and unpressed suits in front of massive forgings or beneath giant cannon, at the inauguration of far distant railroads, at the launching great ships. And so organized, so confident were these men, that their descendants were able to inherit the world's first heavy industries, an enterprise of factories, plants, and yards, in their mechanical know-how, the envy of many a nation. So developed was their trade, that when the demand came for ironclads bigger and better, with cannon bigger and better, they took it in their stride. And so you find Hiram Maxim, who not only invented a gun, but also a flying machine just in passing, and Basil Zaharoff, that most enigmatic of all middlemen, who dealt in everything and anything that went off with a bang. A buyer and seller to governments, revolutionaries, and even mandarins. And don't be deceived that they wanted these things just to knock down trees. What sort of a world was it then? A world of the first motion pictures. A world in which the petrol engine was hardly noticeable.
Look out, it's a bike.
Oh, dear. A world in which the century of the common man was only just dawning. A world slithering into the abyss, yet one in which establishments never seemed better established and peace never more secure. Edward VII came once in person to Sheffield to call upon the famed blacksmiths of his nation. And there he received a roaring, heartfelt welcome. For Edward the Peacemaker was the very personification of stability. A stability that was, alas, like beauty, only skin deep. Japanese besieging Port Arthur. Threats from Fashoda to Peking. Battles, brushes, incidents, skirmishes. Boers, Boxers, Zulus, Fuzzy Wuzzies, Afghans, Mahdi's, send the gunboats, send the Panther, Lebensraum, legitimate aspirations, spheres of influence, and the great game. And of course, we don't want to fight, but by jingo if we do. In any trade, even for the blacksmiths of the nation, it is the customer who calls the tune. Here the experience, here the means to make of metal what you will. Pay your money, take your choice. Swords or plowshares. And the customers chose and called for swords, even if only to have them ready in their scabbards. On order, small arms, guns, ships of war, like HMS Dreadnought, the most revolutionary warship of its time. For some, arming was national defense. For others, national ambition. For others, but let them speak for themselves. Dreadnoughts, we want eight and we won't wait. Political slogan. There is no balance of power in Europe but me and my 25 Army Corps. Kaiser Wilhelm. The United States is adverse to restricting the inventive genius of its citizens in producing weapons of war. Captain Mann. France will have but one thought, to become again the France of an idea with a sword. And then she will take back Alsace-Lorraine. Victor Hugo. No wonder that Nobel, who made millions out of gunpowder, wished with all his heart that he could make a weapon so terrible as to put an end to war itself. Dear me, it makes one almost afraid to turn over another page. Enough of that for the time being. Let's get back to the here and now. Here, the very crucible of a whole vast enterprise, grown as it has from the trade of blacksmith to the nation. Apprentices to the sorcerer, cooks in Hell's Kitchen. Their skills the same as in the days of Stevenson, Naismith, and Bessemer. The trade of sweat, brawn, and muscle that once went with overlong hours, meager pay, and homes that were warrens of sooty brick. The trade around which grew whole cities, bursting with civic pride, yet whose water was black and whose air was cold. The trade that through the decades covered Britain with railways, foundries, and mills, and put steel ships on the oceans. The trade that created plants and labor forces like amoeba, swelling, multiplying, amalgamating, until today. Lifetimes later, in a very changed world, a group. Ah, yes, the board meeting. A meeting of the board was held at Millbank at 11:30 o'clock in the forenoon. The main item of the agenda was a discussion of the annual general report of the group to be presented to the shareholders. Think of all the annual general reports over 100 years, with everything that has stemmed from steel and engineering. Barrow, Bilston, Bury St. Edmunds, Crayford, Dartford, Newcastle, South Marston, and a score of other plants, as far-flung as Montreal, Canada, and Perth, Australia. A petrol pump or a subway car? An escalator or a refinery? Custom-built to your special requirements or ready-made from the catalogue? Stampings, castings, forgings, cold-rolled sheet, hot-rolled plate, and extruded rods in various non-ferrous metals. Activities based upon our 1,250-ton extrusion press in the non-ferrous metals division continue at a high level. Boilers, rollers, crushers, kilns and dryers. Considerable attention is being given to the provision of training and education courses for supervisors and foremen. Steelworks plant, cement plant, mechanical handling plant, beet sugar plant, grain and seed cleaning plant, pulverizing plant, turbine, tractor shovels, scrapers, stitchers, diggers and dozers, steelwork for buildings and bridges, hydraulic machinery, railway rolling stock, diesel electric, diesel mechanical. Who can define engineering on such a scale as this, with everything that has blossomed from it? Theodolites, tachometers, tank armor plate. Tanks, now there's a story. A British invention, yet from those first cumbersome crawlers at Cambrai, tanks were only developed in the teeth of opposition. And all the tracked taradiddle, armored and otherwise, that lumbered and lurched up and down as well as round on the proving grounds, met their greatest obstacles in suspicion and scorn. And even when the product took on some semblance of modern form, for some, the acid test of a tank was whether or not it could outpace a horse. Chieftain, 55 tons at the gallop. A monster mounting a 120 millimeter gun able to penetrate any known armor. A speech in the House of Commons in 1933. I must congratulate the Financial Secretary on one point in the Army estimates. There has been no tampering with the cavalry. In the battles of tomorrow, when all the mechanized vehicles have broken down, and when the petrol dumps have all exploded, then the cavalry will come into their own again. Passenger liners, automated cargo liners, large tankers, modern naval vessels. Our technological strength in the shipbuilding group is evident, particularly in the work of our model experimental tanks at St. Albans and Dumbarton. Their research work has attained high standing, both national and international. In commercial shipbuilding, the creation of additional capacity throughout the world, and especially in Japan, made a serious impact on the profitable operation of British yards. Yet the level of activity in our ship repair division for the first 4 months was higher than for the same period last year. Solving the largest of jigsaw puzzles, fitting massive pieces into a prearranged pattern. Unlike the jigsaw, this will be a picture without joins, thanks to the welders and their arcs, melting edge into edge until the myriad parts become the wholeness of a ship. Rather different from the old way. Ribs of the dinosaur, on which to hang each square of metal. Rivets white hot from the brazier, hammered in to sew each plate to the next. thousands and thousands of ribbons until the patchwork is a ship. And many the fine vessel they built that way. And the shipbuilders of tomorrow? White-coated and precise as a watchmaker. As alert for flaws as a diamond broker. For the part under scrutiny is a small yet vital part of an atomic submarine. In a cleanliness of dazzling white, operators like surgeons and as thorough. For here too, life is at stake. The life of every member of a submarine crew. This crew must dwell and work fathoms deep. Their shell must withstand the awesome, relentless pressure of the ocean. We anticipate that the shipbuilding group will be engaged for some years ahead on the nuclear submarine program. From this experience in nuclear propulsion, it may well be that new possibilities will open up for surface vessels. An unsolicited testimonial from the First Lord of the Admiralty, Whitehall, August 1914. We ordered the whole of the 15-inch guns for the ships of the 1912-1913 program without ever making a trial gun. We trusted entirely to British naval science in marine artillery and to the quality of British workmanship. The first of these 15-inch guns was tested only a year ago. In its tests, it yielded ballistic results which vindicated, with what is to the lay mind marvelous exactitude, the minutest calculations of the designers. For missile launchers and fire control gear for the Admiralty still comprise a valuable contribution to the turnover of work, though there has been some slackening off. Bottling, brewery and dairy equipment, cardboard box-making machinery. Mr. Jones, I'm sorry, sir, Mr. Jones is at lunch. Letter opening, letter sealing, franking and folding machines, hydrographic apparatus, refuse disposal plant, hydraulic gates, air valves, aircraft and ancillary equipment. Brooklands, 1911. And they called it a flying school. Who taught there, heaven knows. For who had the experience? While some pushed, others rowed. For without their weight, a sudden gust might end everything. On the elements much depended, and let's face it, on the pilots. But how they blazed a trail with those magnificent men in their flying machines. I can report that the VC-10, with the world's first four-jet rear installation, has gained unprecedented praise from pilots and passengers alike. The first great flights were made with machines like the Vimy, built as a bomber, and now to be tested for long-range pioneering. Their pilots were men like Alcock and Brown, who conquered the Atlantic. Ross and Keith Smith, who made it to Australia. Forerunners and a great parade of men and women who took lonely wing across the globe. In hail, monsoon and sandstorm, over desert, forest and jungle. Ever tired, yet inevitably triumphant, camping under their own wings to the beat of primitive drums. The joy of flight, not the complacence of the ignorant, but the sheer devil-may-care of the brave. They were foolhardy, They were jumping the gun of progress. Yet they created a future in the skies that even their brave vision could hardly have envisaged. On the same site as the Brooklyn Flying School of 1911, on the Weybridge production line. From a catalogue dated 1929, with the development of duralumin, a substitute for wood was at once available. The design of machines with duralumin cum steel has now reached a stage where wood is entirely eliminated. Out of the stable, Vellore, Virginia, Victoria, and many more of their school. Flying boats, a whole family of flying boats, the Viking, the Vigilant, the Southampton, and others. The brain that launched a thousand ideas, Barnes Wallace, whose visions were airships and geodetic structures and any number of shapes to wing the stratosphere at Mach indefinite, not to mention a bomb that bounced. From Dr. Wallace, R.J. Mitchell, and all the others, what a parade. From the Supermarine, to the Spitfire, to the Swift. The Type 510, the Type 535, the Attacker, the Scimitar, the Valiant, first of the V-bombers, the Viking, first of the post-war airliners, the Valletta, the Varsity, the Viscount, that most remarkable and successful aircraft of its day, from the Vanguard to the VC-10. A changing world, hard to keep up with, and one harder still for the task of anticipation. Since it became clear in the 1950s that we had to change from a heavy emphasis on a manufacture of armaments, we have, as you know, been planning an entirely new strategy. A new strategy. High on the hills of Northumberland is a house called Cragside. There, a century ago, lived Armstrong. A man without whom there might never have been a group. There he planned his new strategy, not only for the engineering of which he was a master, but also in new fields that he foresaw, in dynamos and things electrical, in hydraulics, and even telescopes. Even in his day, Armstrong felt the winds of change and endeavored to sail with them. Mr. Jones, I have here Mynheer Bentz. Yes, he has an appointment. You know the way, sir, 26th floor. I'm from Mexico City. With certain modifications to suit our local needs, we feel sure you can meet our requirements.
Yeah.
Frank Milbank, I have a call for you. Is that you, Kurt? Look, Kurt, as you're the people in the group who handle such things, I'm passing on an inquiry from Brazil. Polyester, polyolefin, polymerization. 500,000 working hours spent in trying to improve production methods for synthetic fibers and plastics. All this research to facilitate the building of production units, vacuum vessels, measuring and control systems. To you, Mr. and Mrs. Smith, it adds up to nylons and drip dries and a thousand other things to wear. And to a world short of food, it may mean something else. More land turned to producing things to eat rather than cotton and wool. We have a request for plant erection for production of acetylene. Or is it adipic acid? Or caprolactam? And an example of that kind of work is producing gas for your kitchen from butane. Delivered to your local gasworks, just like the milk. And no need to drill the North Sea for that. And what does this gentleman want? Scientific instruments? Yes, could be. But Then those cases are rather large for microscopes. No, it's probably office equipment, furniture, duplicators, or filing cabinets. On the other hand, it could be printing machinery, from big monsters churning out newspapers by the million to smaller ones for books, brochures, and anything else you want to get down on paper, or on metal. After aircraft, ships and tanks, perhaps a little mundane, but then it's the mundane that makes the world go round. A new strategy to meet the needs of all those millions of customers down there who have the infuriating habit of always being right, whether they live in a palace, a stockbroker's Tudor, a flat, a prefab, or a condemned. Products vital, yet commonplace. Products vital and not so commonplace. A baby, only a few seconds old, but who will die in a few more seconds if prompt action is not taken. The medical division report good overseas sales for their hyperbaric systems, especially with regard to their neonatal chamber, which can be pressurized rapidly to a maximum of 4 atmospheres and which can be operated after only a minimum of training. Seen through the same kind of material once used for the cockpit covers of Spitfires, a different struggle between life and death. A brand new customer, now fully resolved to live, and no doubt in future fully resolved to be always right. But come what may of new strategy, yet still they remain the engineers, the blacksmiths of the nation. There's the huge, the massive, there's the giant ingots to be forged and hammered into a wealth of technology, the very backbone of our world. There's the skill, the knowledge, the craftsman's eye. There's the service in peace and war. There's the experience which from 1914 to 18 gave the customers not so much what they wanted to have, but what they felt they must have, because there seemed little else for it. The customers who marched off to what they earnestly believed would be the war to end war, the one that would be over by Christmas. We don't want to lose you, but we think you ought to go. There's the experience and the mighty effort which turned out the machine guns, the quick firers, the mortars, the field guns, the 15 inches in their turrets, the howitzers on mighty wheels. Look out, Jerry, here it comes. To match the enemy, gun for gun, bullet for bullet, blow for blow, at Ypres, Hill 60, at Messines, Passchendaele, Plug Street, and Polygon Wood, on the Somme, on the Aisne, at Gallipoli and Salonika, on the Doggerbank, at the Falkland Islands, across the Atlantic and the Pacific, a long, long trail a-winding. Sister Susie sewing shirts, and Sister Susie turning out the things of war paced by the consumption of the devil, working full-time, overtime, double-time, summertime, wintertime, every hour of the clock, shaping from metal countless rounds for rifle, machine gun and mortar, Mills bombs, aircraft missiles and shells, millions upon millions of shells, shells in such numbers that if put end to end would have encircled the earth innumerable times, a long, long trail. Until suddenly, there was no more need, and they could all go home. Time to go home, time to knock off. But in terms of human advancement, is it ever really time to knock off? Today, yesterday, tomorrow, all are but part of the unending pattern in which the boss, the foreman, the worker, the consumer are indispensable parts of the machinery of progress. So, let's drop the they, and in its place say we. For us, it was the 20s, marching not to the front, but through the factory gates. Before us, a vision of the world, a better place, peace with plenty. I'm forever blowing bubbles, pretty bubbles in the air. Swords into plowshares, into tractors, railway wheels and motor cars. Make up for lost time. For those of us with our caps back to front, we turned out the shapes that were to break records and establish the airlines. We designed and built the R-100 to fly from mast to mast across the world. Inside, travel in style to Egypt, India, even Australia. The splendid dream that failed. Pretty bubbles in the air. Then reality, in the sleek, speedy winners of the Schneider Trophy. Forge ahead. But for the rest of us, with our caps the right way round, wasn't it hard enough just to stay where we were? The days of too many men for too few jobs. The days of great ships unfinished and rusting on silent slipways. The days when having the cleanest stove in our road or keeping up with the Joneses didn't seem that important. Only the retention of human dignity. Only the queue at the labor exchange. The days when we were thankful for even the meager orders that came our way, because orders kept the sound of riveting alive. And that was the sound that kept men and their families eating. Today, to the young, such things must seem inconceivable. As impossible as being unable to afford a telly or a motorbike. But then, if we hadn't learned from it, we probably shouldn't be where we are now. Then the 30s, and our world just as uncertain as any threatened by the bomb. The League of Nations talks of disarmament, but what about security? Britain's naval might arrays at the Coronation Review. But no more war, sign the peace pledge. Mummy, who's that man with the little moustache and why does he shout so loud? But even without public support or government money, do a little planning, just in case. Even though the man from Munich has brought us peace in our time being but a scant 12 months. It is the evil things we shall be fighting. We are going to hang out the washing on the Siegfried Line. Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye. So once again, it was full time, double time, overtime, through all the hours of the bomber's moon, roll out the barrel, roll out the guns, the ships, the aircraft, the tanks. And once again, Sister Susie turning out the things of war paced by the consumption of the devil. And out of the planning came the Valentine to raise the dust of the desert at Tobruk, the Cauldron, Alamein, and beyond. And out of the planning, too, came the geodetic structure, developed out of experience in building an airship. Only for those of us who flew the Wellington, it wasn't called geodetic, but a good old Wimpy, or F for Freddy, because not only did it carry destruction to the target for tonight, but also precious men, and God willing, brought them home again. And out of the planning came a bomb that bounced. Bouncing to destroy enemy dams, one after the other. While Wallace's 10-tonners and tall boys toppled bridges, penetrated the impenetrable, and turned the mighty Tirpitz turtle. Earthquakes ready-made. Then it was that freedom drew in full upon the legacy of a man called Mitchell, who, dying of cancer, had turned the Schneider Trophy shape into the most formidable fighter of the age. And with that fighter, an immortal few saved not only a nation, but the whole free world. Put out no shroud for Johnny in the cloud, but keep your head and see his children fed. Spitfires for Johnny and his like, mark after mark in their thousands, until their wings were over the Rhine. And suddenly, we had no more need of them. And we could all go home. Experience, the massed experience of over a century. And with it all, continuity.
Name and launch the ship.
I name the ship British Admiral. May God bless her and all who sail in her.
And God bless all who sailed to in Dreadnought, Nelson, King George V, illustrious of the Malta convoys, Toussaint, Orcades, Aurangzeb, Orsova, Oriana, Himalaya, Eagle, Ark Royal, Ajax of the Plate, Cossack of Altmark fame, York, Dauntless, Swiftsure, Unbroken, Indomitable, Inflexible, Iron Duke, Emperor of India, Plunger, Juno, Methane Princess, Resolution, Renown, and all the rest of 3,000 ships that pitted proud strength against the drag chains. Time to go home. Time to knock off. But in terms of human advancement, is it ever really time to knock off? The boss, the foreman, the worker, the consumer, all indispensable parts in the machinery of human progress. And tomorrow, the task, as always, to look ahead, to anticipate what the world will ask for. So on now, into the next 100 years of enterprise, of adventure, of achievement, of challenge.
Started it. Very pleasant occurrence today. Thank you.